हाय चिल्ड्रन, दिस इज कविता मैम हियर. हैप्पी मीटिंग यू ऑल अगेन. टुडे अंडर द ब्रांच ऑफ सोशियोलॉजी वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट द टॉपिक सोशल स्ट्रैटिफिकेशन. यस चिल्ड्रन, अंडर द ब्रांच ऑफ सोशियोलॉजी चैप्टर नंबर 1, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट social stratification. What is the meaning of social stratification? In our human society, when you see, there is a practice of classifying the people as superior, inferior, upper and lower, and assigning them different roles and status in the society, and that is called as social stratification. That means dividing the people on different bases. That is called as social stratification. Okay. Today we are going to see the same topic in a very detailed manner, in what are all the bases the division is being carried on. The first one, when you see, it is related to social inequality. The fact that people are stratified according to various qualities like gender, caste, profession, class and race is a proof of social inequality. So under the heading of social inequality, people are divided, stratified is nothing but divided on the basis of gender, that is male and female, caste, upper caste and lower caste, profession, by based on profession, if they are businessmen of high qualified group, if they are normal workers, daily labor workers of different group, class, race, in such manners the people are divided. And when you talk about this particular divisions, more than this you have on the other side also. That is, the social inequalities are also from income group. That is, you call it as higher income, lower income people, based on education, well-educated and illiterate, and based on professional opportunities, health facilities, political representation and participation, this social inequality is formed. Social inequality is a result of already present unequal social opportunities. Because the opportunities are not the same and it is unequal, these are all the causes related to social inequality. The next term, it is related to education and inequality. Of course, when you have a very good education, naturally your placement, that is after your education, you will get a very good job. A very good job will be fetching you a very good income, and your lifestyle will increase. And it will totally be the other way around if you don't have your education, if you are an illiterate. Okay, in this heading of education and inequality, many articles are there which are directing you. That is, in the sense, how and until what age you'll be getting free education, and what are the other provisions you get from the preamble of our constitution. Let's see. Education is a special structure that brings in equal opportunities. The social justice aspect of education can be seen in the directive policies and the preamble of the Constitution of India. So, in our Constitution of India, education is being given special rights in our preamble. Already about the preamble, you have studied in your earlier classes. In 9th only, I have explained about you. Here also, you have the same continuity. So let us see the different articles provided in our constitution. Article 39 provides social justice and people welfare is the duty of the state government. And 21A, Article 21A of the 86th Amendment to the Constitution tells us that availability of free and compulsory education to all the children between 6 and 14 years. Very important article. That is, the children of 6 to 14 years will be getting free and compulsory education. Article 45 tells us that all children under 14 years should be provided with free and compulsory education. Article 19 tells us that right to speak and right to express one's own opinion is a fundamental right. Article 29 protects our cultural rights of the minorities. Minorities in the sense, in our country, India, when you see, there are different religions, Hinduism, Islamic religion, Christianity, all are there. But when you talk about the major, Hinduism is a major religion. When you talk about minorities, where you find a few people belonging to a particular religion, they are called as minorities. For example, you can take the Islamic people and the Christianity people. So when you find such kind of people in very few members, they are called as minority people. Article 30 is about the establishment of minority educational institutions. That means finding out Christianity schools and Islamic schools. That is related to minority educational institutions. Article 46. It is the duty of the government to support the education interest of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. I hope you know about these people who are called as scheduled caste and tribes. Initially, they were called as untouchables. But later on in our constitution, they had been given a title and they are being holded under a group of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. And the last one, when you see Article 21, tells that the Supreme Court's decision to understand the right to live. So these are all the things which you have to learn and understand and keep it in mind, children. These are all the articles which are very important. This slide is about the gender inequality. Gender, you know the meaning, that is male or a female, that is related to gender. So here, when with the relation to gender inequality, when you see the motivational issues which supports education of a boy or a girl, or if it is based on inequality in other fields like education or with related to food and health facilities, in all these branches you find the gender inequality. Okay, according to the National Family Health Survey 4 of 2015-16, when you see, rural women of Karnataka have a body mass index which is called as BMI of 24.3, whereas urban women they have of 16.2. That is the people who live in village, rural area women and urban women. When you see their body mass index, that is when you see, when you talk about the rural women, it is about 24.3, whereas when you talk about an urban women, they are 16.2. And apart from that, when you see about the anemic children, it is too much severe in India, than that too especially. 60.9% of the children between 6 and 56 months have severe anemia, that is they are too anemic, not having that much of blood flow in their body, that is related to anemic. Iron content is quite less. The next, when you see, 45.2% of the pregnant women suffer from anemia. It refers to the pregnant women. In this scenario, when you see, the development should include the food and nutrition security to the women and children. So finally, we can come to a conclusion, as compared to women, men are far better. And when you talk about women, they should have development with regard to the food they take and the nutritional security what they have. So that much is related to gender inequality. Now, the exact meaning of social stratification we will be studying, but still I have already explained it to you in the beginning of this session only. When the class was introduced for this chapter, I have given you the meaning. I'll still again repeat it. The practice of classifying the people as superior and inferior or upper and lower in the society and assigning them different roles and status in the society is called social stratification. I again make it to you very simple, children. What does social stratification means? Very simple. The practice of classifying the people as upper class and lower class people, classifying them as superior people and inferior people. Superior means very good, extraordinary. Inferior, too poor, too less. Okay, that is called as social stratification. Now, under this heading, we have four features under social stratification. The first one, social stratification is social in nature. What do you mean by the term social in nature? Maybe the stratification is based on social recognition and importance, but not on any physical personalities. For example, when you see, a person's status is not fixed on the physical traits like height, beauty or strength, but it is actually based on what? Education, income, profession, skill and other social traits that is related to social in nature. The next one, social stratification, is universal. That means it is beyond the human society which can exist, we can say. Wherever human society is existing, there and all you will find this social stratification. Everywhere the division of manpower is there. That is, it may be based on labor or it may be based on profession, income, or by any other means. That is why it is called as universal. In all the fields you may find the division of people. The third point, social stratification is ancient. We are not finding this division today. Right from the ancient period, we can find the social stratification which has been in existence. And finally, or in a very simple statement, we can say, right from the nomadic period till today's modern society, when you see social stratification is going on. The last point, social stratification exists in different ways. Different areas also we can say. The social stratification is existing in different areas and also in different ways we can say. Even in the country Rome, example when you take, you know the country of Rome. Even there were differences between people over there also. Actually when you see, they were called as plebeians and patricians. Who are the plebeians? Means they were the lower class people. When you call about the patricians, means they were the higher class people. That is, in Rome, the people were grouped like plebeians and patricians. And similarly, in India, when you take, you have heard about the Varna system, right? Varna system is nothing but the people were classified under four groups. That is the Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. So about this Varna system, we will be studying it in the next slide. And here in this slide, you have learnt about what is gender inequality and also the social stratification meaning and also the features of social stratification. In this slide, when you say we are going to study about the major forms of social stratification. Initially, in those days, when you see the social stratification from the ancient period, when you check out, they are the primitive society. Then we had the form of slavery. Then we had estate system, Varna system and the caste system. Primitive society, you all know, like people were nomads moving from one place to another in search of food. And later on, once they had their settled down place over there, when they finished clearing all those places, in the sense eating the roots of fruits, whatever is available there, living in the hollows of the caves. This was a society how they lived, and that is why it is called as a primitive society. The next part was slavery. Slavery in the sense they are bounded to others. They don't have their own lifestyle. They are bounded with others to work for them for a certain period, and that is called as slavery. That was also a part of a social stratification. Then you have the estate system. More or less, this is also like a bonded labor only. People used to work generation after generation. They used to work with the same people for everlasting time. And that is related to estate system. In a huge area of land, their entire family was tied up. In the sense, they were bounded to the particular person, his superior. The next one is Varna system. Already in the previous slide, I have given you the information what is the meaning of Varna system. And here also I repeat, Varna system is being classified into four. They are Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. Brahmanas, when you see, they are the people who used to give education, recite the Vedas. They used to be in a temple, do the pujas to the god. Apart from that, they used to give education to the warriors, kids, in the sense that the kings used to send their children, their prince used to come there to study. So they used to learn the Vedas with the Brahmana, and hence he was considered to be a teacher. Kshatriya, of course, you all know he is a warrior born to fight. Vaishyas, when you see, they are all business people, maybe rice merchant, gold merchant. So such kind of people doing business, they were called as Vaishyas. And Shudras, when you see, they were all daily laborers like a cobbler, weaver. Such kind of people were called Shudras. So our Varna system was divided into four, called as Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishyas and Shudra. The last one was related to our caste system. People were divided on the basis of caste. So these are all the major forms of social stratification. The next one we are going to study is about untouchability, a social evil. Of course, even today also when we utter the word untouchability, it is extremely a deadly evil, social evil. But nowadays in the modern society, we don't divide the people under any cause. We live under one roof as all are one. So initially, in this heading also, we start with the first statement telling the four Varna system of the Vedic period are Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. The fifth group, actually we have four groups, four Varna system. The fifth group was considered as untouchables. The British government, in that particular period only, they gave them a title called as Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes. In which year do you know? According to the Indian Government Act of 1935. The British government, through its India Government Act 1935, classified the untouchables and tribal people as Scheduled Caste and Tribes. These untouchables got a title, and in the sense they were put up under a community called as Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes. According to some great leaders, when you see, many people had fought against the social evil. You can talk about Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, Gandhi Ji, Ambedkar. Many people have raised their voice against the social evil. Here to put a statement, according to Gandhi Ji, untouchability is a heinous expression. Heinous is nothing but wicked, very cruel act. When you treat a person, a human being, as an untouchable, then you are called as a wicked person. You are called as a cruel person. So this was stated according to Gandhiji. According to Gandhiji, untouchability is a heinous expression of caste system. This is a leprosy attached to the Hindu skin. You know the disease as leprosy, a very deadly disease. So it is something like that way when you treat a person as untouchable. So this was a statement given by Gandhiji telling, untouchability is a heinous expression of caste system. This is a leprosy attached to Hindu skin. Who tells these words? It is Gandhiji. Ambedkar's fight to address the issue of untouchability is a noted one. Even Ambedkar raised his voice for the cause of untouchability. He wanted to end this term called as untouchability. Problems. What are all the problems faced by the untouchables when you say? In a book, Manusmriti, there is a saying that anyone who touches the untouchables had to undergo purification many times. According to Manusmriti, anyone who touches the untouchables, who are called as Chandala, had to undergo purification many times because it was very much adhered to all the principles. The next one, as per Vyagrapada Smriti, if touchable person comes within the distance of the tail of a cow with the untouchable, he could purify himself with the bath. According to this Vyagrapada Smriti, it tells that if touchable person comes in touch with an untouchable, that too, what is the distance? The tail of a cow. To that distance also, if each fellows are meeting one another, that is a touchable person and an untouchable person, naturally, the person, that is a touchable person, had to purify himself by having a bath. He immediately has to go and have a bath when he touches an untouchable. One more example we can take, that is in Malabar. In Malabar, that is a part of Kerala, it is a place in Kerala, untouchables made footwear, that is they used to make slippers and all, but they were the one who used to make it. They are the one who had to make it. And after those people manufacturing it, they were not having the rights to use them. They were not allowed to use. This happened in which place? In Malabar. Untouchables made footwear, but were not allowed to use them. And finally, they were not even allowed to touch wells, tanks, and cemetery used by the touchables. That is, previously you are very much familiar of this term. Untouchables, they never used to allow that. They were not allowed to enter the temples. They were not allowed to take water from the well. There were so many restrictions, and this was followed in those days. In this slide, we are going to see about the untouchables who were kept out of education. nowadays world, when you see, each and everyone has got the right to have their education. We call it as a fundamental right. All must have education, which is being said in our constitution. But in those days, when you see, when you talk about the condition of untouchables, it was really pity. When the ordinary people, when they were entering into a temple, sitting and reciting the Vedas and all, these untouchables, they were not supposed to listen also to the Veda recitation, nor recite them also. If at all they come to know about it, they are not able to utter those words also. Whatever the Veda they have learnt, they are not supposed to recite also. And the most worst thing was, they were barred from learning Sanskrit. They are not supposed to learn that language, Sanskrit. So this was giving a very toughest period to Ambedkar. That means he felt, what was wrong for the people, untouchables, to have education? So considering this in mind, he fought very hard to make the people realize the importance of education. He felt it, that even the untouchables untouchables also should know the importance of education. Hence, he wanted to make the people realize. Having realized the importance of education in individual's life, Ambedkar argued in favor of education as a public property. When they said, don't take water from the well, don't enter into the temple, when all these were said, he felt that, okay, that is fine, but what about this? Education is quite important. He made it as an issue that education is a public property. Due to rich revolutionary ideas and thoughts, Ambedkar could come up with more provisions and directives in the draft version of the Constitution of India, and he is rightly called as the chief architect of the Indian Constitution. So when there is a question, who is the chief architect of the Indian Constitution? It is none other than Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So he had some initiative thoughts and ideas, and he felt that it should be made compulsory for this people, untouchables, to have their education. And so he proved it in the constitution by drafting so many privileges for them, and hence he is called as the chief architect of the Indian constitution. After this, we are going to study about the denial of property rights. Generally, when you see, the property will be transferred from the grandfather to his son, probably the other, I mean the son, from him it may pass on to the other generation. It keeps moving on from one generation to another generation, the property. But there, when you talk about the untouchables, they were not allowed to have property only. That means they did not have the right to own the property. Untouchables. Traditionally, the untouchables were not allowed to own any property and were only expected to serve their masters. This was the very worst thing in the life of the untouchables. That is the denial of property rights. The next one is denial of political participation rights. Everywhere denial only, refusing, not permitting them. Denial is nothing but deny, refuse, not allowing. So here when you see, it is about the denial of political participation rights. Not allowing the untouchables to participate in politics. But here also Ambedkar was very strong. So in the traditional political system, untouchables were not allowed to participate. During the British rule, the untouchables got few political rights. Initially, in our ancient system, no rights for the people, untouchables, to participate in politics. But during the period of British rule, the untouchables got few political rights. But due to the efforts of Ambedkar, the untouchables could get opportunities in politics and administrative areas. Because of him, the people had the right to participate in the elections. In the sense, they had to, at least they had a try to enter into the politics. This is related to this heading, denial of political participation rights. The most important slide, the heading, the legal measures to eradicate untouchability. Throughout this particular chapter, we studied about the stratification, that is the social stratification, how people were divided, on what basis they were divided, right from the ancient stage, traditional stage until today, what are all the problems faced by these untouchables, how they were recognized, and the leaders who fought behind it, everything we have learned. Finally, to conclude, what are all the legal measures to eradicate untouchability? What can be done to eradicate untouchability, remove untouchability from the society? What has the government done? First point, Article 17 of the Indian Constitution prohibits untouchability. Article 17 tells nobody should create a sense of untouchability. In the year 1955, the Government of India has implemented an act called as Untouchability Offences Act. That means when anybody plays a role of untouchability, dividing some persons as a basis of untouchable, then that will be created as an offence. In the year 1976, Protection of Civil Rights Act was implemented with necessary changes to the Act of 1955. What happened in 1955? The Act, for that, in the year 1976, some changes were made, and according to this Act, when you see, practicing untouchability is a crime. The next point, universal right to vote and participate in elections has also been provided. Initially, untouchables did not have the right to enter politics. They were denied of political rights. But here when you see, universal right to vote, everybody has got the right to vote, including those untouchables, and they can also participate in elections, which has been provided. Moreover, reservation has been given in the field of education and employment for scheduled caste and tribes along with backward classes. The very much notable point we can see. Reservation has already been given. That means in the field of education and employment, a certain percentage is fixed for them. That is, when they belong to that particular caste and tribe, scheduled caste and tribe, reservations are there for them in educational field. That is, in schools and colleges, even in their jobs, everywhere they get reservation. The SC and ST, Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989, has given some specific responsibilities for the government in the eradication of untouchability. All the points are very important in this slide. Many a time this question is being repeated in the board papers. So give more importance to this particular slide, that is the legal measures to eradicate untouchability. Already in the initial slides you have seen about the articles, and these are the furthermore articles what you have, and it is just to have a glance. And here you have no explanations because these are all the repeated points only. I'll just read out for you once. Article 15, 16, 17, 38, 39 prohibits any discrimination among the Indian citizens. Each article tells that no Indian should be divided on the basis of caste. Article 16, 4 and 324 has provided reservation in the employment for scheduled caste and tribes. Already we have studied these untouchables who were called as scheduled caste and tribe have got reservations in the field of employment. Article 330, 332 and 334 provides scheduled reservation for scheduled caste and tribes in politics. Previous one, it was related to employment for SCST people. Here also you have for SCST people only, and that is related to reservation in politics. The last one, Article 25, tells you that the government has given the rights to all the people to enter public temples. Initially I said you untouchables and all, in those days they did not have the right to enter temples, and you will be very much familiar with Ambedkar's Kalaram temple movement, isn't it? Yeah, even that you can just bring out and touch with this particular article also. So there they were prohibited to enter temples. But here when you see, Article 12 is giving you the rights to all the people to enter public temples. This is your assignment slide, children. Fill-ups are given. Answer the following questions are given. And the explanation is given in detail for you for the entire chapter. A quiet, important chapter which has got more articles related to it, and the last slide which I said you, that is legal measures to eradicate untouchability, the most important slide, give more importance to that particular slide, and with the help of the entire slides try to complete this assignment. Hope you understand it. Thank you, children. Bye.